more than destiny. I'm so alive, you're the air I breathe.
Uh-oh. What? I can't use the stand. I can't use this. And I can't drink your water. I get pushed around like this at home, too. You have to be home to get pushed around. Hey, yeah. Huh? Well, if I could lean on it, but it still is not locked. Huh? The Bible and a wheel? Oh, and the wheel? It depends on whose will I'm in. I'm talking about a legal document there, not... Anyway... Listen, this is going to be not normal today, okay? Band's taking the day off. We got a couple of people that are going to sing, and you're going to be involved in a praise medley in just a little while. And listen, when we get the opportunity to praise in song, don't do it like you're embarrassed by God, okay? Because that doesn't please Him very well. Now, I know that some of you are out there saying, well, I just don't sing. This is predominantly men. I just don't sing. Well, at least smile, okay? Because the Lord God says, according to the psalmist, that He inhabits the praises of His people. So if we want to experience His presence, then we need to praise Him for who He is. So you're going to have that opportunity shortly. In the meantime, let me tell you about the agenda otherwise. In just a few minutes, we're going to have you get up and take a look at what we spent 5.5 hours doing yesterday in our vision workshop. And you can see them on the board, on the walls here and here. And over here behind Lewis. Yeah, it's right behind you, Lewis. Matter of fact, it's 4 of them. Matter of fact, Ken, you're going to have to help Lewis move when people start moving in that direction, because I don't want him to feel like he's getting overwhelmed by the crowd. But we had 30 adults here yesterday who spent 5.5 hours with our ICMP consultant, and we did a lot of work on discovering what discipleship really is, and we looked at where our weaknesses are and where our strengths are, and we are trying to discern God's vision for our church over the next 5 years or so. And listen, we want you to be a part of that. Even if you weren't here yesterday, and you may say, well, I'm not a member here yet, but if you attend on a regular basis, if you contribute, then certainly we want you to be a part of what we're doing. And so for just a few minutes, probably 5, 7, 8 minutes, 10 minutes at the most, we're going to take a little time right in the middle of the service, and we're going to let you move around and take a look at these things that are hanging on the board. And there are 4 of them over here in quadrants. And some of the folks that are here, you know who you are. If you were here yesterday, raise your hand. They're gonna migrate to these places, and if you don't know what you're looking at, just ask questions, and they're going to tell you what these things are about. And in the meantime, the reason we want you to do that is because we have these sticky notes. So they'll talk to you about what's on these papers as far as our big ideas and our vision and our mission and what the five-finger approach is to sharing the gospel with people and things like that. And if you are mulling this stuff over and an idea pops into your mind or a thought or a concern or anything like that, I want you to write it on a sticky note. And after the service, I want you to go to whatever sheet it applies to, and I want you to put the sticky note on that, because we want your input as well. Okay? And these things then are going to be taken down, and the church health team and the church prayer team are going to be working together to just kind of funnel this thing and develop a vision, a strategy that fulfills our God-given vision and mission, so that we can get four or five things that we can do quite well over the next 5 years. We're not going to try to be everything for everyone, and we're not trying to build a mega church. We're trying to determine why God has us here in this place at this time in history, and what we can do specifically to make a difference in the community within 3 miles of the church. Okay? So you can help us out by that, by doing that. And I don't know how to distribute these. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn them over to my treasurer, because she is the most analytical person I know, and she can look around the crowd and say, all right, this is the way I need to do it. And then she'll make Bud do it. Okay? That would be the chief operations officer.
CCO.
CEO, CCO, CFO, CIA. And you have your announcement sheets. So, PhD, MD, MDiv, BA. A lot of people graduate with BS. That stands for Bachelor of Science, folks. What are you laughing at? SALT number 4 starts today, I think. And that is the physical, how to bring your body under the control of the Lord Jesus. So these are all small groups that you can get into no matter what time it is. You can get in today, 5 o'clock. If you haven't come before but you'd be interested in this, and it's going to cover a lot of things about health issues. So I hope that you'll try to be a part of that. Miss Elaine Kaiser back there waving her hand. She's going to be facilitating that. She also happens to be in the healthcare profession, so she will probably be able to give some insights from that perspective as well. Our second generation group of leaders has their SALT study on Wednesday night. I'm reading it through the light backwards, so just be patient with me. And also our Novenation in Prayer. All that happens at 6:30 on Wednesday, and you can see the things that are going on Thursday, including our youth meeting here. And then Saturday at Canaan Church, Carlton Baptist Association, we're having our annual archery event. It is a tournament, and there's a fee for folks that want to shoot in the competition. But kids under the age of 12 shoot for free. You don't have to have your own equipment. They've got equipment out there. We got lots of exhibits. Scott Hanna, who's the pastor of Black Creek Baptist Church, is going to be speaking. Whatever the Road's going to be doing the music. If you're not familiar with Whatever the Road, that's from a song, I think, a country song. Jason Aldean. Anybody know who Jason Aldean is? I don't have a clue, but I think it's from one of his songs. But if you're still wondering, that's Joey and Amanda Campbell, Whatever the Road Ministry. So they're going to be doing the music. And North Walterboro is preparing, I don't know, maybe 25 or 30 barbecue Boston butts, so it's going to be outstanding. It's a good family day. It's a good family event, isn't it, Stacy? It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. And they also sell tickets, because we have some pretty significant door prizes. And you will enjoy that, and your kids will enjoy it, okay? Is that enough? You're going to set your clock forward in two weeks, right? Come up here and have my seat. because Vicky's going to be getting up in a minute. Now, join with me as we pray. Lord our God, you are the El Roi who sees us as we are and yet loves us without limit. Today we beseech you in the person of the Holy Spirit to help us to truly worship you in spirit and truth. We do not want to be as those who desire the convenience of feeling right, but deny the conviction of living right. So convict us of our sins and break us to the point of confession so that we might be forgiven and cleansed from all of our unrighteousness. Lord, I thank you for gathering this people in this place at this time in history, and this is not without purpose. So as we continue to seek out your direction for our future as a church family, help us more than anything to be a prayerful people who spend more time listening for your voice than we do talking to you about things you already know. Today, remind us that the time is nearer than ever before, that time that history will come to an end and judgment comes. Reveal yourself today to those who might not be ready for that judgment. Let them know that you see them in their brokenness and despair, in their pain and their sorrow, in the confusion and uncertainty that might be plaguing them, and that you love them and desire to give them abundant and eternal life. Strengthen them to battle through the distractions and demonic dissuasion so that they might obey your call today to confess and forsake sin, to turn in faith to confess Jesus as Lord and Savior, and just to do it. Lord, you are El Gabor, the prevailing and conquering God, to whom we ask, guide us as your people to pursue you first of all and your vision and purpose for us as we seek to build your kingdom in Jesus' name.
Oh, to Jesus I surrender, all to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence. Daily live, I surrender all, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender.
Amen. Nova Church, we are here to worship and have a good time. All the worship, the praises we sing to the Lord, thrill him. They show him that we love him. So everyone, our band is taking a vacation day. So we're going to sing with some people who sound a whole lot better than all of us. And I want you to all stand, and let's get ready to clap and have some fun. You know all these. Yay! Ready? All right, you know this. Come on, let's hear ya.
Come, now is the time to work. Before your God, come,
just as you are to us. Come, just as you are before your God. Come,
one day.
One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now.
Oh, you're gonna love the next one. Woo! You love this one? I knew this was a favorite. And I love it. Power and love as we sing holy, holy. a good worship song? May be seated.
Good morning, everybody. This morning's reading is from the book of Ephesians. For this reason, I fall on my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth receives its true name. I ask God from the wealth of his glory to give you power through his strength to be strong in your inner selves. And I pray that Christ will make his home in your hearts through faith. I pray that you may have your roots and your foundation in love, so that you, together with all of God's people, may have the power to understand how broad and long, how high and deep is Christ's love. Yes, may you come to know his love, although it can never be fully known, and so be completely filled with the very nature of God. To him whom by means of his power working in us is able to do so much more than we can ever ask for or even think of. To God be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus for all time, forever and ever. Amen.
Okay. God, no. Oh, no. Oh, no. No, 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 no. I'm fine. I'm fine. Hey, bring the lights up. I see better like this. All right. Here's what we're going to do for just a few minutes. Okay? First of all, is there anybody here that was here yesterday that has any comment? Well, I tell you, for a group that was so talkative yesterday, you sure are quiet today. You had a good time? What did we talk about? Did everybody get that? It's almost like us speaking in tongues, wasn't it? Because we had so many people talking at one time. But I think you get the idea that they thought it was a worthwhile investment of their time. So as we get ready to do this, they're going to be moving. And you all know who you were. Just move to a place that you were involved yesterday, okay? Whether it was in the large group or in one of your smaller groups, so that you can answer questions, all right? And you know what's going to really disappoint me? What's really going to disappoint me is if nobody moves but the people that were here yesterday. So don't break an old man's heart. Okay? Even if you're not interested, get up and walk over there like you are. Okay? If you're a guest, you know, you can see what we're going to be doing over the next 4 or 5 years, all right? A couple of passages of Scripture. First Corinthians chapter 12. Now, what Mel read, I'm going to be speaking to you about in just a moment. We're going to be really zeroing in at the end on those verses that we serve a God who is able to do far more than we can think or imagine. And He does it through a power that's in us. But listen to this from 1 Corinthians chapter 12. As the body is one and has many parts, and all of the parts of that body, though many, are one body, so also is Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body. It doesn't matter whether we're Jews or Greeks or slaves or free. We're all made to drink of the one Spirit. So the body is not one part, it's many parts. If the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I don't belong to the body, in spite of this, it still belongs to the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? And if the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But God has placed each one of the parts in one body, just as He wanted. And if they were all the same part, where would the body be? And you get where this is going? What's He talking about here? What's He talking about here? What's the specific thing He's talking about? The church. The church. The church is the body. And who make up the parts? Yeah, and see, all the parts are different and they have different functions because that's the way God designed it. Yeah. Now, he goes on to talk about the fact that some of the most important parts are the ones that are least talked about and least known. For instance, you probably don't think about your intestines that much, but you let them get blocked up for a couple of days, and that's all you can think about, isn't it? I never thought about a little finger very much. But I have arthritis in that finger now. Can you see it? You see the lumps on it? It's always red and it's always inflamed and it's hard to bend. And now that thing captures my attention more often than you would believe. My wife, she likes to hold my hand and sometimes she likes to hold a finger. And if she's on that side of me, she has a tendency to grab that little finger until I start screaming like a little girl, and then she lets it go. You know, you don't think how important it is, but when one part hurts that you don't even think about, suddenly you realize there's some function in there. And the way you usually find out that there's pain is when you try to use it. Now, we're all important. If the body is going to function as it should, every part has to do its purpose, fulfill its purpose. You're part of the body. You go over to that Ephesians passage and you look right over to the next page or the next chapter. In chapter 4, he's talking about the same thing, unity and diversity in the body of Christ. Verse 16, he says, from him the whole body is fitted and knit together by every supporting ligament and promotes the growth of the body for building up itself in love by the proper working of each individual part. And you say, why is he talking to us about this? Because before you stand up and start looking at these things and asking questions, I want you to understand that it's going to require all of us. It's going to require all of us pitching in. It's going to require all of us acknowledging that we are a part of the body of Christ, if indeed you are a follower of Jesus, and this is where you feel like he's brought you. And that we all have a role to play in fulfilling the mission and the vision that he's given us. I don't know what your part will be. Yeah. Unfortunately, my part is that I have to be on this stage every Sunday. Yeah. Unfortunately, my part is that I have to be out front. I don't like that. I'm an introvert by nature. There's some of you that serve so faithfully and nobody ever knows about it. And that suits you just fine. But there are far too many parts of our body that find themselves just taking in nutrients and never expending any energy. You know what happens when you continue to take in nutrients and don't expend any energy? Yeah, you end up with a fat Jesus. Remember, the church is the body of Christ. And we end up with a fat Jesus because we don't expend the energy that he gives us when you come to a place like this or a small group, or even when you're listening on TV to some religious program and you feel like you're being fed in your spirit, but you don't use what you hear to be involved in the mission of the kingdom of God. So that's what I want you to do. I want you to, when you're looking at these things, I want you to also be thinking, how can I be a part of this? What can I do? And well, Kennedy, it's been a long time, darling. I'm guessing this time it's not because she heard my voice. Okay, good. Thank you. Kennedy, from the time she was born, used to cry every time I got up to preach. Anyway, those of you who were participating yesterday, go ahead and move to your spots. And listen, it's 8 minutes after, about quarter after, I'm going to call time. And then we'll give you a couple of minutes to get back to your seats. And if you have any questions, just ask these folks that are there. They are moving kind of slowly. Nobody's going that way. Now, these sheets are just worksheets, but it's going to give you an idea of what we're looking at as far as what we want to concentrate on for the next 5 years. Ready, set, go.
You just want to wait a little while?
I can just wander around.
Are y'all trying to come up with, like, mission, vision?
We have our mission. Thank you. You want to take the children out now? Are you? Huh? All right, let's find our seats, and I'll tell you what. Those things will still be up after the service. There will be a notepad near each of them. And if you want to add something, just write it on the sticky note and stick it where you want it. Okay? But the purpose of this is that we want you to be a part of what God is going to be doing, not just in us, but through us for the community over the next 5 years. Okay? Mr. Zane? What did you say? What's not to love? All right, I knew I said I'd give you a couple of minutes to get back to your seats. So, the 30-second countdown now. I'll let you know when it's 15 seconds. Ten seconds. All right, Rakim's last, so he buys lunch for everybody today. Hey, thank you so much. I just love having you here, and I love you being a part of our worship experience. We're getting ready to move into the preaching now, the teaching. I want to introduce you to Miss Melissa Hinton. Her husband, Kevin, is preaching at Hopewell Church out in Adams Run this morning, and you're going to have the opportunity to hear Miss Melissa, who is now going to be coordinating our children's ministry. Thank you. And by the way, yesterday, Miss Weezy Paget said, I'm going to help with the 2 and 3-year-olds. So she's on our prayer list forever. And Melissa has quite a voice, too. Okay.
I've chosen, hope this will work, is Jesus Never Fails. Churches.
Thank you.
Children, half the congregation, that's right. You ever have one of those nights when you can't sleep and you're just sitting on the couch or laying on the couch and you start thumbing through the TV looking for something interesting and it's hard to find? But then they came along with a thing called MeTV and GetTV. Now, those of you that are younger will not understand the affinity that some of us have for MeTV and GetTV. But when you're my age, it shows programs from your childhood, back in the 60s. One of those nights that, you know, God awakens me for some reason. I can't sleep. I've spent some time in the war room. I've prayed. I've been in the scriptures. And then I grab a cup of coffee and I go, because I can drink coffee and sleep. But I grab a cup of coffee and I go sit on the couch and I'm thumbing through, and I don't remember if it was on GetTV or MeTV, but I happened upon Gomer Pyle, USMC. And I don't know if you remember that show. I know they do a lot of Andy Griffith stuff now, but I wish they'd bring back some more Gomer Pyle. It was a classic situation comedy. You know, 30, 40 years later, it's still funny. It's timeless. This particular episode, Sergeant Carter, who was played by Frank Sutton, I mean, just a great actor. Everybody in the platoon was going to have the opportunity to take command. Gomer was very worried about this. He just knew that it would be absolutely impossible for him to command those men who seemed to be so much smarter and so much more worldly than he was. But one day, he was visiting an elderly relative who just happened to live in California, because he was at Camp Henderson. And she spoke to him about the leadership abilities of some of his ancestors. And then she gave him this small metal emblem that allegedly had been worn after being awarded to his grandfather during his military career. So he sticks that emblem in his pocket, and from that point on, Gomer was like a different man, and his attitude was different, his demeanor was different, and when he assumed command of the platoon, it was an impressive thing to watch. Then when he went back to his relative's house, I think she was an aunt, told her the good news about how well he had done in command of the platoon, she asked him if she could have the emblem back. Gomer gave it to her, and he follows her as she goes into the kitchen, and when she got to the kitchen, she took the emblem and she impressed it back on the refrigerator door. Because you see, it wasn't a military award and it had no mystical powers. It was just an emblem that represented pride and quality in the craftsmanship of a refrigerator that was made. And the moral of the story was pretty familiar, considering what we have as our text today in Ephesians chapter 3. This aunt wanted Gomer to realize that he had the leadership qualities the whole time within him. Now, we as individual followers of Jesus and far too many churches live and breathe and act and work in a defeated state. About 75% of our churches are plateaued and declining nationwide, maybe closer to 80% now. It's estimated by a study done by New Orleans Seminary that less than 5% of our churches in Southern Baptist Convention, that's 46,000 churches, are actively growing and not growing by transfer of membership growth, but growing by people coming to faith in Jesus, building the kingdom of God. Probably nearly 50% or more of our churches are living and acting in what you might call a survivor mode. They're just trying to stay alive, not making much of an impact for the kingdom of God, which is, and by the way, do you know that throughout the Gospels, Jesus talks about the church just 3 times, but he talks about the kingdom of God over 50 times? Now, as much as we love the church and as important as the church is, we've made a business out of the church here in the United States of America in the last half century. We've made it a business. And our denominations have not helped that because our denominations function on numbers. And it's no different than it is in college football or basketball or anything like that. Money follows success. So if you have the numbers, then you have more resources. What happens with little tiny churches that are out in the rural areas that just don't have the resources, and they really don't have the expansive mission field that that churches that are in more developed areas have? Let me tell you something, Dan. Between 900 and 1,000 Southern Baptist churches die each year. They actually close their doors and cease to exist. But 25% or more of those are in places where the populations are 50,000 or more. So it's not just rural traditional churches out there that are dying. And, you know, about 25% of the church plants that we plant don't survive 5 years. So what's happening with the church? You know, we're living and acting as if we don't have any power. And what we do is when, and you know, it's become so evident with the just divisive nature of politics in this country nowadays. By the way, I want you to know right up front that God does not identify with the Evangelical Conservative Republican Party. In fact, I try not to identify myself anymore as a conservative evangelical because so many people connect that with the Republican Party. God does not identify with the Republican Party. He does not identify with the Democratic Party. He does not identify with any political organization or agency. He doesn't identify with conservatives. He doesn't identify with liberals. God loves everyone equally. Okay? God loves everyone equally. But what we've started doing is, because there have been so many pressures brought to bear on what we identify as evangelical Christianity, that is, we become a group of whiners. You may block people on your Facebook that use foul language. I tend to block Christians on Facebook who whine about everything that the government's doing and everything that the homosexuals are doing, because whining accomplishes what? Nothing. Nothing. You know. Jesus told us in John chapter 16, the world is going to hate you at some point. And why are they going to hate you? Because they hated me. So even when we find ourselves under attack, we need to come to the point where we realize, hey, Jesus said this was coming. It should make us stronger. Stop the whining, pick up the armor, and let the Spirit fill your life, so that you can go out there and be a warrior and take charge spiritually of your own life. Paul writes about this in these verses that Mel read in chapter 3 of Ephesians. And he ends it with that kind of doxology in verses 20 and 21. One of my favorite verse couplets, it's, "Now to him who is able to do above and beyond all that we could ask or think according to the power that works in us." You see that? "To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever." Let me tell you something. It reminds us that we have within us as followers of Jesus the power to do more than we could ever dream or imagine. But most of our limitations are self-imposed and are usually based on fear or tradition or just complacency. There's an organization in the Southern Baptist Convention. It's not really... It's called an auxiliary to the Southern Baptist Convention. It's called the Woman's Missionary Union, WMU. Okay? Any of you ever heard of WMU? And it has age-level organizations for children through adults. And what WMU, which is a little over 100 years old now, why they were organized really was to kind of help us overcome those fears and break the bonds of tradition and counteract the creeping complacency that was coming into our convention when it came to missions. I believe that when it was birthed by some great women like Annie Armstrong and in this state, Mrs. Janie Chapman, I think it was brought about by the Holy Spirit, because what the WMU has done over the years is constantly challenge the Southern Baptist churches to support globally and nationally and even locally missionary responsibility. And those things are still fundamental to us as a church and to us as individuals. And it's the foundation of evangelism. It's three things: you have to pray, you have to give, and you have to go. That's what WMU supports. That's what WMU pushes. By the way, the reason I say they're an auxiliary to the Southern Baptist Convention, and I think it was because they decided early on, we don't want no men trying to mess this up. So, but they've been a bastion of mission support and prayer and service for the last 100-plus years, encouraging people to give and to pray and to go. Paul reminds us in these verses that you heard Mel read that every Christian has within himself or herself the power of God to accomplish whatever it is that he wants you to do. When you find yourself limited, yet God is calling you, those limitations are self-imposed. Now let me tell you a little background about the book of Ephesians, okay? Undoubtedly, it was written by Paul, and it was probably somewhere about 30 years after the death and resurrection and ascension of the Lord Jesus. And undoubtedly, it was written from a prison cell. In the first verse of the third chapter, in the first verse of the fourth chapter, in the 20th verse of the sixth chapter, he mentions his status as a prisoner for the Lord Jesus. It is one of the most comprehensive letters that he wrote, and it's written in very general terms, and it's not addressed to any particular group in the earliest manuscripts. So it could have been a circular letter that they would send out, which simply meant that it was circulated to a group of churches. But what he wrote in it appeals to Jews and Gentiles, and it's just as true in the 21st century as it was the day it left his hand to go to the churches that he was sending it to. This book deals with the church on a universal level, the big C church, and it deals with the church on the local level, like all of the churches that are following Jesus here in Colleton County. It is a doctrinal letter. Almost every fundamental Christian doctrine can be found in this letter. It is a letter with specific practical suggestions on how to live a godly life, and it's a devotional letter, which I think is the most important part of it. Throughout the letter, Paul talks about and stresses the importance of prayer. Why is that true? We talked about it yesterday. This sheet right over here on the yellow wall has the six functions of the church. Biblically speaking, those are the six functions of the church. And worship and prayer come first because they are foundational to everything else. They are foundational to evangelism. They are foundational to ministry. They are foundational to fellowship. They are foundational to discipleship. Now, we can do a lot of programs to try to do all those things, but unless we are worshiping God in spirit and truth every opportunity that we can, and unless we are spending more than just a cursory time in prayer in the presence of God to hear His voice and to follow His word, then those other things are not going to be accomplished because we have to bathe them in prayer, as Paul emphasized throughout the letter. And then the thing that I love is when he talks about his praying for us, look at verse 14. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. And I pray that he may grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with power in the inner man through his Spirit, and that the Messiah may dwell in your hearts through faith. I want you to think for a minute and imagine. That 2,000 plus years ago, in a prison cell in Rome, Paul prayed for you. And here's what he prayed specifically. Four things. The first is he prayed for everybody who would ever read this letter to know the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's verse 17. That the Messiah may dwell in your hearts through faith. Now, it's a fundamental truth. It's a basic. A person cannot live in a way that pleases God apart from Jesus. You just can't. It makes no difference how morally good a person may be. It makes no difference how generous they may be. It makes no difference how humanitarian or how religious they may be. Unless there is a faith commitment to Jesus Christ as Lord, there is no hope for a life pleasing to God. When Jesus was walking the earth as a man, he told folks, he said, I can only say what I hear the Father saying, and I can only do what I see the Father doing. He spent his entire 33 or so years that he was here not acting of his own will or accord and not doing his best. He spent all that time making sure that he was doing what God wanted him to do. We've got a lot of people out there who profess to follow Jesus who are just plodding along, doing the very best they can and feeling defeated at it. We got a lot of churches filled with those people who are doing the best they can to keep their churches alive, and they're feeling defeated while trying to do it, all because they're not doing anything about being in the presence of God, being in intimate relationship with the Father, hearing His voice, enjoying His presence, understanding what it is He wants us to do, and getting out and doing it. You ever heard that term, don't work harder, work smarter? So why are you trying to work your way to heaven? When Jesus just said, follow me. Why are you trying to work yourself to heaven? Yeah. You know what really pleased me as a pastor and a friend? Is if I came up to you and said, I want you to do this in the church, and you could honestly look at me and say, you know what? I want to help any way I can, but that's not where I'm gifted, and that's not what God's called me to do, and I'm sorry, I can't do it. If I knew that you were a praying person and you said that to me, I would say, yay. Because there are too many people doing too many things that they never were called to do and are not gifted to do, and they're not doing them well, and it just feeds the mediocrity that we find in most churches. You can't work your way into heaven. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6. The Word of God says, without faith, it is impossible to please Him. There are hundreds of quasi-Christian groups all around the country, and they're offering thousands of people every year a false hope for a meaningful life, and some of them are claiming to be Christian. And this will upset some of you, and that's okay. Mormonism, New Age movement, prosperity preaching. Occasionally some of your favorites, like Joel Osteen. Listen, everybody, my devotion in the book of Deuteronomy this morning, and if you're following me with that, I'll tell you about that a little later when I post it. But in that devotion, God said to the people of Israel, when a man rises from you as a prophet and he speaks about something that he's dreamed about or something that he says that I've told him, and it happens to pass. Well, what would you think about that? If it comes to pass, as he said, what would you think about that, huh? If somebody said, God spoke to me in a dream and said this, and what they said prophetically actually happened, what would you think? That God told him that, right? God said, if that happens, and then this person says, now, let's worship another God. You know what God said to do? Go ahead and kill him, because he's a false prophet. Just go ahead and kill him. Even if he tells you that I've spoken to him and it comes true, if he says, but let's follow another God, take his life. You think God takes his relationship with you seriously? That point being, every now and then blind squirrels will find a nut, right? So even false prophets can speak something that is true from time to time, but make sure that what you're listening to is biblical, because we got these people all over the place that are just leading people astray because so many people are searching for meaning and purpose in their lives, and it's all associated with how I feel. I know it's hard to swallow sometimes for some folks, but Jesus has never promised in your life that you would be feeling good all the time. In fact, what he did say was to call us to a life of self-denial and taking up our cross and following him. Many are looking for answers or security or peace, and they're struggling in their own strength and their own efforts, hoping to mend a spirit that is broken by sin. But here's the truth. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Only a personal faith relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ can bring salvation and open your life to the power and the resources of God. That's the only thing. You have no Jesus in your life, you have no power. Jesus becomes the Lord and Savior of your life. God the Father has basically said, everything that I have and everything that I am is yours. You understand why Paul was praying that you would know the Lord Jesus? Now, he also prayed that his readers would understand the scope of God's love. You know, look at verses 18 and 19. I pray that you, being rooted and firmly established in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints the length and width and height and depth of God's love, and to know the Messiah's love that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with the fullness of God. Do you know how much God loves you? You ever thought about that? Yeah. You know when I like to think about how much God loves me? When I'm in pain. When I'm in fear. When I'm uncertain. When I was initially diagnosed with cancer, my focus was constantly on how much God loves me. And the reassurance that because of how much He loves me, nothing is happening in my body or my life that He's not aware of and that He's not capable of taking care of. The breadth, the length, the height, and the depth. Here's how someone suggested that His love reaches upward to include all of the heavenly hosts. His love reaches down so far that it even includes those in hell. And it stretches out to those who are wandering far away from the Lord Jesus. There is no one in any generation, in any place, at any time, who is outside of the reach of the love of God. His is a love that is without condition and is beyond the normal understanding of most people in the world. But we who know Him would someone get me another one? Thank you. Y'all can go out of here today and say we saw our preacher doing a dance on the floor and taking off his clothes. Ah, and he ain't no Magic Mike. Thank you. We who know the Lord Jesus have a responsibility to carry the message of that love to the world, demonstrating the love of Christ through our lifestyles and our verbal witness. Jesus said when He was talking with His disciples at the Last Supper that He would have with them, after He had washed their feet, really, the function of a servant, sat down and He said, "You call me teacher and Lord, and you're right about that because I really am the teacher and Lord. I expect you to do to one another as I've done to you. I've washed your feet, you ought to wash each other's feet." It was just an act of serving one another. And then He made this statement in John chapter 13, in the 13th chapter of John in verse 34 and 35. By this, let's see, this is plural, right? Is this plural? It's singular, right? So it's a single thing. By this will all men know that you are my disciples, that you love one another. Have you looked at any churches lately? Have you heard about any church divisions, any church strife, any church splits? You ever wonder why the people of the world don't want to come to our churches? You know? And folks can say, "I got enough drama in my life without going to the church and finding more." You know, if those people loved each other like they were supposed to, that might be attractive. But I'm not going to go there. We have to show others the great scope of God's love. And what that means is that we have to be able to love those people that, for all practical purposes for us, seem unlovable. Hard to do when they've hurt you. Hard to do when they talk about you. It's hard to do when you got four or five knives in your back. And yet that's what Jesus told us would mark us as belonging to him. And then he's phrased not only that we understand the scope of Jesus' love, but that we might experience the fullness of God. We're missing out on that, my friends, that we might be filled in verse 19 with the fullness of God. I don't know if any of you have ever thought about that, but I've often thought, how could I take in the fullness of God? As awesome as he is, that he could hold the world on the tip of his finger, how can I contain the fullness? But the problem is not in our inability to contain him. Our problem is our unwillingness to receive him. For those who have a faith relationship with the Lord Jesus, those of us who are here, who've said, yes, I know that I'm redeemed. I know that I'm going to heaven when I die. Well, he desires to fill you with capacity with his spirit. There are far too many of us that step away from it at that point, and we say, you know, I want to make sure that I'm going to heaven when I die. I want to make sure that I have access to God, that I can pray when I need to. But, you know, there's this part of my life that I don't want to make any changes in, and there's this thing in my life that I don't want to give up. And so I'm just going to keep the Lord Jesus and his spirit in a certain part of my life. You know, those are the folks that say, you know, I keep my religious life and my personal life kind of separated. You know who makes those kinds of statements? Lost people. Again, because Jesus came to die for you, and what he's asked of those that follow him is that we die to self. Deny yourself. Luke 9:23, if you want to look it up, okay? Luke 9:23. If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Jesus doesn't want to be in your life. He wants to be your life. That's allowing the fullness of God to come in you. To be filled with him is to have at our disposal his wisdom and his power and his resources. To be filled with him is to have the capacity for this full and meaningful, joyful life, no matter what our circumstances. To be filled with him means that we will live a life as God intended and is pleasing to him in the way that we speak and think and act. Then in verse, the last thing is, he prayed that his readers might be strengthened with God's power. Verse 16, he's talking about that. If I can find it. I pray that he may grant you according to the riches of his glory to be strengthened with power in your inner man through his spirit. He's talking about that spiritual being that you are, you know. He prays for us to have this spiritual rather than physical strength. He prays for us to have a strength that comes from the fullness of the Holy Spirit in our lives, a strength that empowers us to do far more than we could ever dream. I know some of you. I've talked to some of you. I know that you feel like God's called you to do certain things, but you say, I can't do that. I don't have the skills. I don't have the education. I don't have the background. I've never done this before. I know there's some of you that say, well, you know, that all of this is intriguing that you talk about this Jesus, and I have a relationship, and I want it to be strong, but I don't know if I'm ready to take that step of total surrender or commitment. You know, the thing is, if you play poker, which I quit when I failed out of USC because I tried to major in it. But you know, there's those occasions when you really feel confident that you push everything that you have in front of you into the pot and you say, I'm all in. I'm taking the risk here. and you push it all to the pot because you're so confident of the hand you hold. That's what faith is, really. It's being so confident in what God says he will do for you that you're ready to say, you know what, no more of this half-hearted commitment to God. I'm going all in, all the way. So that when the flesh says to you, you know, you can't do this, you can say to them, him, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Whenever the devil or some little demonic minion that he uses that may be running around in your office or in your school says something about you that you think, I can't resist that or I can't deal with that, you then remember that Jesus inspired Paul to write, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Because we, none of us, can in our own power live in a manner that pleases God. None of us in our own power can make an eternal positive impact on anyone. None of us in our own strength can find any power or fulfillment or joy in life that lasts a lifetime. But when we commit our lives in faith to the Lord Jesus and really surrender ourselves to him, there it is. Verse 20. He is able to do above and beyond all that we ask or think according to the power that works in who? Us. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. Look, I just don't want you to be a plotter. I don't want you to be somebody who is not experiencing great joy in your life. You know, we all got problems. We've all got issues. We've all got challenges. We've all been hurt. We've all lost people. We've all had our own battles, and we all have these demons that just scream at us from time to time. We all have these things that happened in our past, in our childhood. There's none of it that we cannot overcome when we are filled with his power. Stop plotting. Stop doing the best you can. Stop feeling overwhelmed and defeated and yield yourself to God today. Let's pray together. You know, that's not going to only, that's that kind of commitment on your part is not only going to be good for you, it's going to strengthen your church, not necessarily here, wherever your church is. Because you are going to be an active, vibrant, powerful member of that congregation who's constantly seeking the will and the purpose of God. Now, for some of you, it's going to require that today be that time when you say, you know what, I know a lot about Jesus, but I don't really know him. But today I'm going to start to know him better. I'm going to follow him with all my heart. Open yourself to his power by simply praying something like this. Right where you are, you don't have to pray it out loud. God, I know that I'm a sinner and there's nothing I can do to change that about myself. Confess that to you. But I also know, because the Bible teaches me, that that's why you sent the Lord Jesus to die on the cross. He did that just for me. That his death might provide the forgiveness of my sins. His blood would wash away my guilt. I could be born again. He was raised from the dead so that I could have eternal life as promised. Not only that, he sent his spirit so that it could fill us with the presence of God and give us his power. But today I'm humbling myself and submitting you. For the Lord Jesus is my Savior and Lord of my life. Today is the day that I'm born again. If that's your prayer, you prayed it. It's important. It is important. It is important. Get off to a good start. We've got some materials to help you with that, and it's so important because, let me tell you something, over the next week, you're not going to believe how the devil's going to come against you to tell you that what you've done and what's happened is not real. You need to be strengthened by that. So we've got some stuff to help you, and we've got some folks that want to pray with you before you leave today. You can help us know who you are by just lifting your hand right now. I prayed that prayer today, and I was born again. I followed Jesus with all my heart. So raise it right now. Raise it up and hold it long enough for one of the guys to get there, and then we'll be moving on. Now, church, our Heavenly Father is poised to do far more than we could ever imagine or think. But He's going to do it through us. And we have to be a people of prayer, and we have to be a people that are committed. We have to be a people that are humbled. We have to be a people that are united by distinct and great love for one another. That's my prayer as we stop today. That Nova Church would be that kind of united body, seeking only the glory of God in the building of His kingdom. For those of you that may be going on to other churches, that's my prayer for you, that you'll do that in your church as well. Lord God, we thank You so much for Your presence here and for Your desire to use us to make a difference in our world. God, I pray that You would help us to be united in spirit and in love, that You would move across this congregation. God, that You would bring conviction where there's sin, that You would bring healing and forgiveness where there's confession. And that You would just empower us to do all that it is You want to do in us and through us to reach a world out there that's broken. We love You, and may this spirit of worship continue even as we leave this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Thanks for coming. Salt's this afternoon at 5:00.